What's the smallest JavaScript program you can write that prints out exactly the set of five-letter words that are allowed as guesses in the puzzle game Wordle? Here's one such program. It puts all the words into a big array, and then it prints them in a for loop. This program is 117,871 bytes long, and we can definitely get a lot smaller than that. Here's a rather more clever program that saves space by eliding common prefixes of successive words. This gets us down to 38,656 bytes, which is a lot better, but it's still very far from the best we can do. Golf.horse is a website where solutions to this challenge can be compared on a public leaderboard. The purpose of this video is to explain some ideas from one particular entry submitted by Jed Grabman called Decision Trees. This entry was ranked number one for 2.5 weeks during July 2023, before being surpassed by Luke G's Zymic, which has its own separate write-up you can read at this URL. A good way to get a handle on this problem is to reframe it as writing an encoder and a decoder. The encoder takes a word list and emits a sequence of bits, while the decoder converts that sequence of bits back into the original word list. Once we have this set up, we can feed our desired word list to the encoder, and then package up the resulting bit sequence plus the decoder into a JavaScript program, and we're done. The hope, of course, is that the encoding compresses the word list as compactly as possible. Actually, we should be saying word set rather than word list, because by the official rules of golf.horse, order does not matter. One straightforward way of encoding a word set is to iterate alphabetically through all possible strings and to emit a 1 or 0 for each, depending on whether it's in the word set or not. This gives us 26 to the fifth power bits, one for each string of length 5. That is kind of a large number, but don't worry, we'll be improving it. For the Wordle word set, the vast majority of these bits end up being 0, because there are only 12,947 words. So let's modify our encoding to take advantage of that information. We split the encoder into an action encoder and a bit encoder, and we similarly split the decoder. We define two kinds of action. Y means yes, this string is a word, and N means no, this string is not a word. Out of 26 to the fifth power total actions, 12,947 of them are Y. Let's call this fraction D for density. The Noiseless coding theorem tells us that we can encode these actions using approximately log base 2 of 1 over d bits for each y, and log base 2 of 1 over 1 minus d bits for each n. We can add those expressions up to get an estimate for the total number of bits needed. And we can rewrite the estimate in terms of the binary entropy function, h. When we evaluate the estimate, we get 146,091 bits. Now, using JavaScript template literals and base 125 encoding, we can achieve a packing ratio of roughly 7 bits of data per byte of JavaScript source code. So we end up with about 20,900 bytes of JavaScript. We do still need to count the bytes needed for decoder logic, but this is definitely on track to be the smallest solution we've seen so far. To see how we can squeeze our program even smaller, consider first the simpler problem of encoding the set of two-letter Scrabble words. By using the same approach as before, we can encode this set in about 426 bits. However, doing so ignores some exploitable patterns in the data. Look what happens when we reorder the alphabet so that vowels come first. As you can see, most of the words are now clustered together in some relatively high-density regions. We can cut up the space along the boundary of these regions, and then separately encode the subsets, giving a total of 270.5 bits. There is an additional overhead cost involved in cutting up the space, because the decoder also needs to know how to do it. For now, I will skip over the details of that and just assert that we can specify this particular partitioning in about 70 bits, so we arrive at about 341 bits, which is significantly better than the 426 bits that we started with. To better understand what's going on here, consider this plot of H, the binary entropy function. Let's suppose that our aggregate word density is D. H tells us how many bits we need to spend, on average, to encode each action. Suppose now that we've cut our space into two subspaces with word densities D1 and D2. Then D is a weighted average of D1 and D2. We can write the total cost of separately encoding these subspaces in terms of the weighted average of their individual encoding costs. Perhaps surprisingly, the result is always less than or equal to the original cost. And that's precisely because H is a concave function. So the main question is whether the cost that we save by making this cut is greater than the overhead that it incurs. Of course, ideally, we would select our cut such that D1 is as close to 0 and D2 is as close to 1 as possible, but that's not always easy to do. So how do we represent these cuts? Here's an example subspace that we might have. There are 5 slots, each of which has a set of possible letters. The first letter can be C, P, or T. The second letter can only be R, and so on. Here are some example words that fall within this subspace, and here are some words that don't. Lower fails to match on any slot at all, and treat fails to match on the fourth slot. We construct a binary tree of these subspaces, starting with the universal root node, which contains all possible strings. To split a node, we select one of its 5 slots and a subset of the letters for that slot. Strings that match the subset on that slot go to the left child, while strings that don't match the subset on that slot go to the right child. And then we keep making more splits. Often, discriminating by whether a letter is a vowel or a consonant can be very beneficial, but we're allowed to make any split that we want. In fact, there's an enormous number of ways to construct trees in this manner, and finding an optimal one is no easy task. Here's another way to visualize these binary trees. Each tree node is depicted by a rectangle whose area is proportional to the size of its subspace. So that's the number of possible strings, or equivalently, the number of actions. The color of a rectangle is determined by the density of words within that subspace. You can see that this eventually carves out some small regions of noticeably higher density. And that's good because it means we're getting the bit cost down. This is just doing a very simple, greedy search, and it gets the total bit cost down to about 89,000 bits, of which about 7,750 are overhead for representing the tree structure itself. Coloring by density is easy to understand, but coloring by entropy is more informative because that's directly proportional to the number of bits we need to spend. Now we can explore some of these brightly colored subsets and try to understand how to optimize them better. Let's start over again. This time, the first few steps are hand-chosen. Then at about step 20, we go back to greedy search, but this time with a 2-step look ahead. That peters out after about 400 steps, and then we switch to random local search, where we try small mutations of the tree and check whether they improve anything. At that point, you can see that the tree overhead starts going back down a bit. Our final bit cost here is just above 80,000, which, when packaged up into a JavaScript program, puts us comfortably below 13,000 bytes, which is pretty good. While we're here, it's fun to explore some of these subspaces. The biggest one is more than a quarter of the total area, and it's very sparse, with only 8 words. You might say that these are the least wordy of the Wordle words. I can't even pronounce most of them. Some of the subspaces have 0 words, and some of them have fun little poetic clusters like blaff, bluff, chaff, choof, or this one, bogey, bony, coley, coney. Or my personal favorite, the Bowie Cozy Fix-It Moxie subspace. Over here we have the most expensive leaf node, which costs us 959 bits. Maybe if we stare at these things long enough, we can get some insight about how to lower our bit cost even more. It seems to me that we can probably still get a lot more mileage out of this general approach. For one thing, there's a huge number of optimization strategies we could try when searching for a better tree. So far, we've only tried constructing the tree top-down, which tends to lock in early decisions, making it difficult to broadly explore the space. Perhaps bottom-up tree construction could fare better. Another idea is that we could mix in some classical compression techniques like context models so that the leaves of the tree could share some information with each other. If any of this sounds interesting to you, I do encourage you to give golf.horse a try. Check the video description for links to some of the code I've been discussing, and let me know what you learn.